According to the popcorn rule, it's time to start. Very few popcorns are coming in the door. Hi, I'm Melissa Franklin, and I'm going to introduce our wonderful speaker, and welcome to our research lecture series. How many people are from the public? Yes.
Woohoo.
Great. Thank you very much for coming on this snowy night. Tonight we have Daniel Eisenstein, and he's a really interesting guy, actually. More interesting than most of the people speaking. He's a theorist and an experimentalist at the same time, and that makes him really, that's a pretty powerful person. He was an undergrad at Princeton, which is a big powerhouse of astrophysics, and then he came to Harvard Physics Department for graduate school, another huge powerhouse of astrophysics. Not really. But we do have the Center for Astrophysics here. Then when he graduated, he went to the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton, which is usually for theorists, but since he's half a theorist, they took him. And then he went to the University of Chicago, another powerhouse in astrophysics. So he's been touching, the only one he's missed so far is Berkeley, I think. Oh, Caltech. And after that, he was a professor at the University of Arizona for 9 years before we brought him back here. We were kind of missing him. And he's been here for the past...
Four and a half years.
He recently was indicted by the National Academy of Sciences. and he won a very, very prestigious Shaw Prize, which is with two other guys, for the work he's going to talk about tonight. And the work he's going to talk about tonight is about dark energy, and it's about actually constructing a really interesting ruler for which you can measure the universe. So should I say anything more? And no. I really like the guy. I hope you'll like his talk.
Well, thanks very much, and I really do appreciate everybody coming out tonight to learn a little bit about dark energy. I'm going to be telling you about the Sloan Digital Sky Survey and what we call the Baryon Acoustic Oscillation Method, which is all based on cosmic sound. So I'll hope to explain that all as we go along. The outline of the talk is to first try to introduce you to some of the basic aspects of cosmology and dark energy. I'm then going to tell you about this phenomena called the Baryon Acoustic Oscillations and how we use it to measure the universe. I'll then introduce you to the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, which is the large redshift survey that I work on. And then we'll talk about how the SDSS has been able to detect these acoustic oscillations and what we've learned about it. So to start, we're going to start with the question of what is the universe made of? An obviously very basic question, but it's turned out to have very surprising answers. And I think many of you are familiar with some of the surprises, but of course, a big one is this idea of dark matter. So it's a thing that was observationally actually first noticed in the 30s and then ignored until the 70s. But basically, when you look at galaxies within clusters or you look at stars within galaxies, they are orbiting within the galaxy or the cluster faster than can be bound by the material we see. So we infer there must be additional matter that would keep these things in their circular orbits. And we've now been able to intuit that that this extra matter is not normal stuff. It's not just normal protons and neutrons in forms that we haven't yet been able to detect. It's actually some new exotic thing. And recently, with gravitational lensing, you can actually see the mass. You can see the same object lensed multiple times. That really gives you a very direct proxy for how much gravitational mass there must be there. But the problem with these methods in galaxies or clusters is that you're really stuck within measuring how much mass is in that cluster or in that galaxy. It's hard to decide how much mass might be out there between the galaxies. So we'd like to expand upon this and go ahead and weigh the universe. And to do this, the most extreme version is to work on the largest scale we can, namely the scale of the entire universe, and to use the expansion history of the universe to try to determine the gravitational effects upon that. So basically, if you have more gravity, the universe is expanding, and if you would think that gravity would be pulling on things and causing that expansion to slow down over time. And the more matter that you have in the universe, the more deceleration you would expect to get. So that's the process that people set upon. Now, when we talk about the expanding universe, the way that we do this is with Doppler shifts. And a lot of people sort of just throw out the word Doppler shift and or redshift and stop thinking about it. I thought it might be useful to see a spectrum of a galaxy. This is a spectrum wavelength from the blue to the infrared. And here's the spectrum at relatively near to us, at low velocity. And you see these characteristic double lines here. These are calcium lines. And if you look out to the next object, they're a little bit higher in wavelength, a little bit higher in wavelength, a little bit higher in wavelength, a little bit higher in wavelength. This is caused by the Doppler shift of these objects as they move away from us at speeds, in this bottom case, approaching half the speed of light. So these objects are moving very quickly. Now, this is well explained by a uniform expansion as we all sit in this room and we imagine tomorrow we come back and the auditorium is twice as big and you ask how far did you have to move, then the person sitting next to you has only moved a little bit. They've moved sort of a couple feet. The person on the other side of the room has had to move 100 feet. So the velocity that they have to move to accomplish a doubling in size is proportional to the distance from them. This is the well-known Hubble law. And this is this relationship, linear relationship between velocity and distance for small distances. Now, this Doppler shift or recessional velocity is what astronomers usually call the redshift. So in this talk, I'll be talking about it as this parameter z. And this quantity is such a fundamental quantity for us that it's really how astronomers typically talk about the passage of time or distance. Is when we want to label a particular epoch of the universe, we tend to label it by the redshift because it's such an easy thing to measure. OK, so this process of weighing the universe involves trying to figure out the size of the universe, the expansion history of the universe, versus look-back time. So I've made this plot where I've just put the universe into ballistic motion, no forces acting on it, it's just expanding away. And here we are at time zero and at unit size. And if we extrapolate this line back, we would come back to some point of zero size, aka the Big Bang, at some time in the past, in this case, 14 billion years ago. And the redshift corresponds to a given size. So if we say that an object is at redshift 1, it actually comes from a time when the universe is half its current size. OK, so that's the idea. If we now think about a decelerating universe, well, a decelerating universe should be expanding faster at the beginning and then should slow down. So you can see that the decelerating universe at a given redshift will have less look back time. At a given redshift, it is more recent and therefore will have less distance. The objects at that time will look closer to us. They will look brighter. So the idea of weighing the universe was, and people were trying to do this in the 90s, was to go out and measure objects at a given redshift and try to compare how much flux they have. If the universe has more matter, it should be decelerating more, and the objects should be therefore closer, and they should be brighter. And of course, the great surprise was that, in fact, the objects were too faint. And they were sufficiently faint that the amount of matter that you would interpret in the universe is actually negative. So something is actually pushing the universe to accelerate. And we now label that as dark energy, an unknown energy source filling space. And today, this dark energy outweighs the dark matter and all the normal matter by about a factor of 2. So here's a plot. Here's the same plot now adding a line for acceleration. So this is a universe that decelerates initially, and then by now is actually starting to accelerate. And you can see this object, this universe now has more time, more distance, and therefore objects will appear fainter. So the key for us to measure this acceleration is to measure this relationship of distance to redshift, or look back time to redshift. So I'll be showing you plots later on, so I thought it would be useful to flip the axes here. And so now we have redshift along the bottom and distance along the top. And a decelerating universe would have a shorter distance to a given redshift, and an accelerating universe would have a larger distance to a given redshift. All right, so from all this work, from the supernova work, from other work, we've determined this composition of the universe that where we are just this little tiny wedge of the pie, And we have dark matter, which is much bigger than us, but still only a tiny fraction of the, or a small fraction of the story. And we have this behemoth dark energy filling about 70% of the universe. So of course, the big question is, what is this dark energy? And there have been many possible explanations advanced. I sometimes joke that dark energy, the word dark energy, actually overstates our knowledge by a factor of two, because all we really know is that it's dark. We don't really know that it's energy. So of course, the famous example is Einstein's cosmological constant, which may in fact be the answer. But it could be some new force of nature that acts on large scales and provides some repulsive force on large scales. It could be that we misunderstand gravity and that gravity really has some new story on large scales. People have invoked extra dimensions, saying this is, you know, some signature of higher dimensional theory that gravity is breaking down. And there's just shelf feet of journal with different ideas about what dark energy might be. And I think it's fair to say that all of these ideas are exotic in some way. I think the cosmological constant doesn't read as exotic to some people because it's been talked about for a long time. But honestly, it's a very weird thing to have the cosmological constant. And I would say that, you know, none of these is so aesthetically compelling. Apologies to if you're a proponent of any of these models, but I would say that none of these are so aesthetically compelling, except to their authors, as to be the obvious preference. It's not like general relativity, where sort of there's an acclamation that this is a simple theory, and we can a few tests actually really hammer it home. I think here it's a situation where we don't intrinsically have an aesthetic guide. So we are trying to do better observationally, and a main way of doing this is to make very accurate and very precise distance measurements to 1% or better. Now, for those of you who followed astronomy over the last 50 years, you know that the measurement of distance in astronomy is a very controversial topic, and people spent most of the 20th century arguing about the Hubble constant, which is the distance scale of the universe, at the factor of two level. So I'm going to tell you now that we're at 1%, and that should be that should make an impression. Okay, so the way that we're going to do this is this idea of baryonacoustic oscillations, and this is just my one slide précis for the next, you know, 15 slides, but just to get you the basic idea. So the idea is that sound waves propagate in the first 400,000 years after the Big Bang. I will show you these sound waves in a minute. And they create a very distinctive feature in the clustering of galaxies. Namely that pairs of galaxies, if you have two galaxies, they are more likely to be separated by 500 million light years than by 400 or 600 million light years. There's a peak in the distribution of the separations of galaxies about 500 million light years. And once I tell you that there's this peak at a given scale, now you can use it to measure distance. Because if I tell you that I'm 6 feet tall and you look at me and measure an angle, then you can infer how far away you are from me. And that's the idea here. If I now take this ruler, which we call a standard ruler, having now, you know, calibrated the size, and I move it to different distances, then we, just by measuring a change in angle, you can infer accurate distances. So that's the program. And now I'll try to explain these pieces in more detail. So the story really starts with the cosmic microwave background. The CMB, of course, is this radiation left over from the Big Bang. It's about 3 degrees above absolute zero, a seemingly tiny amount of energy, but in fact is the biggest story in the first 400,000 years. It's the big actor. And this, basically, the microwave background, most of the photons are coming to us directly from this very early time in the universe, and we're seeing basically a baby picture of the universe. And it's a very boring picture, right? The early universe is very simple, just the same in all directions. Of course, people have not stopped there. They started working to try to determine variations, and by the early 70s, they had made a picture with a factor of 1,000 in contrast, and they start to see this dipole signature across the sky, which is due to us moving relative to the microwave background. And you can start to see the hint of the galaxy. This is a projection where the galaxy is coming across the middle. That by itself is not telling us very much about cosmology. So they've pushed further. And now we routinely work at precisions of order of contrast of 100,000 or even a million. And this is the picture from the WMAP satellite at a contrast of 100,000. So basically, you know, this is the 3 degree background. And some spots on this map are 100 microkelvin hotter than other spots in the map. That's the story. So this is actually a picture of tiny density contrasts in the universe 400,000 years after the Big Bang. We're basically looking out, and we're seeing a thin spherical shell that we're at the center of, and we're mapping out the density contrast on this shell. These anisotropies, these temperature variations, are incredibly important. They're tiny, but they're really one of our most informative cosmological sources of information. You know, they're really the bedrock of our understanding of modern cosmology. There's lots and lots of things about the microwave background. One could give an entire talk on the microwave background, anisotropies. I actually think that at this point we could give an entire cosmology course only talking about the cosmology from the point of view of the microwave background. You could hit almost all topics in cosmology from it. But today I'm going to be focusing on a very specific aspect of these maps, which are these acoustic oscillations. So if you sort of take a part of this map and just blow it up on the screen, your eye can see a sort of characteristic size of the hot and cold spots. And you know, the spots just have, you know, sort of typical size around the size of one of these blobs. It's about a degree on the sky. And this is not caused by the resolution of the telescope. This is actually a characteristic feature in the universe at these early times, which has to do with sound waves. So the way that we try to quantify this is to take this map and measure the fluctuations in this map as a function of sort of wavelength on the sky. So you can think about trying to decompose this map into sort of spatial frequencies. You can talk about how much power is there in long wavelength modes, how much power is there in short wavelength modes, how much power is there in intermediate wavelength modes. And when you do that, you make a plot like this, where these are the largest angles on the sky, the longest waves, these are the shortest waves, and this is the power. And you see this peak in the spectrum around 1 degree scale, which is what your eye is picking out on that last plot, and you see harmonics of it. So this is really like, you know, an organ pipe, where the length of the organ pipe is giving you a fundamental scale, but you also have all the overtones. You have the things where the organ pipe can complete, you know, two waves in the length of the pipe, three waves in the length of the pipe, four waves in the length of the pipe. That's what we're seeing in this characteristic frequency response in the CMB. If you find the harmonics here in this early plot from WMAP uninspiring, here's a more recent plot from 2011 from the South Pole Telescope, where you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and maybe the ninth harmonic. So we have this beautiful structure on the sky. The sky is really telling us that there's this very characteristic length scale, and now we want to try to understand what that is. Okay, well, the source is sound waves, and where do these sound waves come from? Well, there's this very important transition in the early universe, so which I've already alluded to. It's the time of 400,000 years. Prior to this time, the universe is sufficiently hot and sufficiently dense that all of the hydrogen in the universe is actually ionized. So the electrons are stripped off of the protons. When the universe expands, it gets colder, and eventually those electrons and protons find each other and become neutral. That this process is called recombination. And when we talk about the microwave background coming from redshift of 1,000 or 400,000 years after the Big Bang, we're really referring to this transition from an ionized plasma to a neutral gas. Well, why is ionized plasma so important? The reason it's so important is that if this room were ionized, we would not be able to see each other. Photons cannot travel very far in an ionized plasma. They scatter off of the electrons. And so in the early universe, if you have a chunk of plasma and you squeeze it, the photons can't get out. They're basically being trapped in a compressing piston, and that will tend to upscatter them and make them, you know, blue shifted. It'll tend to give them an extra energy, and that will increase the pressure in that region. And what will it do? Well, that pressure, eventually, as you try to compress it, the pressure builds up, and eventually it actually reverses the compression and forces that region back out. It will actually overshoot, become too cold and underpressured. The rest of the universe will push back, and it will oscillate. This is exactly like what's happening in this room when we're talking in this room. These are sound waves. In this room, it's an oscillation between the inertia of the gas and the pressure fluctuations through the air. The only difference here is that the restoring force is not the random motion of the air molecules. It's actually the radiation pressure of the photons. But other than that, these are acoustic waves. So this is very important because it says any fluctuations you set up in this early plasma actually just oscillate as sound waves. And that's the origin of this word, acoustic oscillations. So really, in the early universe, all the perturbations, inflation, cosmic inflation has caused perturbations across the universe, and these are all just oscillating as sound waves. Now this comes to a screaming halt at recombination, because now the universe becomes neutral. the gas and the photons stop talking to each other. That's why we see the microwave background, is that the photons now have a very long mean-free path. They can travel to us. So now if you take a packet of that gas and you squeeze it, gravity takes over and it just pulls it in more and more and more. So you have a gravitational instability. So you have this big transition in the universe from perturbations being stabilized and oscillating as sound waves to perturbations being unstable and growing because of gravity. All right, well, why does this create this characteristic scale? So let's think about this from a point of view of just a cartoon model, where you imagine the universe that's been perturbed only at a single location. And in this initial overdensity at some little location, it's overdense in dark matter, overdense in gas, overdense in neutrinos, overdense in photons. And because it's overdense in photons, it's also overpressured. And if you have a region that starts off being overpressured, the way that it tries to equilibrate is driving a spherical sound wave out into the room. You know, if I took a balloon and popped it, you know, really what's happening is that there's a spherical sound wave traveling out. So it launches a spherical sound wave. This wave travels out at the speed of sound, which happens to be relativistic, 57% of the speed of light, because this radiation pressure is really, really, really strong. And it will do so until you get to this epoch of recombination. At recombination, the photon pressure departs, and the sound speed drops to nearly zero. So the wave kind of freezes. And it at that point is a radius that today is 150 megaparsecs, about 500 million light years. So it travels relativistically for 400,000 years and really creates a very large length scale in the expanding universe. Well, at this decoupling, we see the photons traveling to us. And so all that structure in the microwave background is actually seeing these sound waves, at the time of decoupling, is actually sort of taking a snapshot of these sound waves. And that's the modulations that we see in the microwave background power spectrum. But the story that I'm going to be talking about is the imprint, the much more subtle, unfortunately, imprint of these sound waves on the clustering of galaxies much, much later in the universe, billions of years later in the universe. And in this case, it's because you have this initial overdensity, which has more dark matter. It will happily form more galaxies there. But the sound waves that traveled out for it have also created an extra density now, which is 500 million light years away. But that extra density will also promote gravitational instability, and you'll preferentially form more galaxies at that location too. So you preferentially are going to form galaxies at the center and galaxies on the outside. And it's this preferred separation, the radius of the sphere, which is the effect that we're going to talk about. I'm actually going to skip this slide in the interest of time. OK, so now the beautiful thing is that the final radius, this 150 megaparsecs or 500 million light years, is actually a very easy thing to compute, because it's simply how far could a sound wave travel in the amount of time that it had. And that depends on very simple physics, just the speed of sound and the amount of time. It really is a high school physics problem in some sense to calculate what this propagation is. This is not fancy stuff. It's just sound waves. In detail, this depends upon the speed of sound, which depends upon the amount of inertia in the fluid, which depends upon how much gas you have. And the amount of time you have to propagate depends upon the ratio of how much dark matter compared to normal matter, compared to radiation you got. So there's some things you need to measure. But it turns out that the microwave background anisotropies actually give us beautiful measurements of these quantities. So we can actually calibrate this ruler extremely well. It's now known, the length scale is now known to 0.4%. So I should probably stop giving the talk saying 500 million light years at rounding off to one sig fig, because in fact I could quote the number to two or three sig figs, 0.4%. So we now can use this as a standard ruler. Once I now know that this signature is 500 million light years, I can go and use it to measure stuff. I can measure it in the CMB and determine how far away the CMB emitting region is. And I can also use it in our lower redshift galaxy surveys, and from this measure distance as a function of redshift. Now, unfortunately, it is a statistical signal. I've explained this in the context of a single perturbing point throwing out a sound wave. But in fact, all parts of the universe are perturbed. They all throw out sound waves. And we're left looking for this correlation pattern. So you don't get to see little bullseyes in the data. That's not what we get to look for. We get to look with signal processing techniques trying to pick out a small excess in the correlation function. And because this scale of 500 million light years is large even to astronomers, we need very large surveys to go and look for this. This 500 million light years is actually a long way away, even for us. Okay, so we want to map the universe. And of course, most of the matter is dark. So we have to find out something in the universe that's actually bright. And those things are galaxies. So the way that we like to map the universe is with galaxy surveys. So we start by making a map in two dimensions, just imaging the sky and finding the galaxies. And then we're going to try to add the third dimension by taking spectra of the objects, measuring the Doppler shift, and using the Hubble law to basically sort the nearby objects from the faraway objects. And when you do this, you can see the beautiful large-scale structure of the universe. The galaxies in the universe are not at all scattered randomly. There's lots and lots of structure on scales of millions of light years. But I should say that this map is pretty small compared to the 500 million light year scale. Now, redshift surveys have a very long history. And in fact, a lot of that history was actually written here at Harvard in the Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics with the famous CFA redshift survey, the Geller-Hookra initial surveys, and other big projects that came out of the CFA. I'm going to be telling about a more recent version, which is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. And the largest maps today use about a million galaxies. They're basically making maps of about a million objects across the sky. OK, so the SDSS is the world's largest galaxy redshift survey. We use a dedicated 2.5-meter telescope shown here, which is in Apache Point, New Mexico, up above White Sands and Alamogordo, if you've been down into New Mexico. The project actually was sort of begun in 1990, so we're actually having our 25th anniversary this year. We started taking data in 1998, and it's still running, and we now have funding to continue until about 2019. So we're going to have a long run with this. It's the world's largest compilation of astronomical spectroscopy. About 4 million objects have been observed. And we have very long-standing support from the Sloan Foundation, Department of Energy, National Science Foundation, and now over 50 member institutions around the world. It's been a really wonderful collaboration to work in. One of the disadvantages in talks like this is I cannot name all the people who have made this survey possible. It's been just a gigantic effort over many years, hundreds of people. And I think one of the beautiful aspects of it is just how people with many different interests come together. I'm going to be telling you about dark energy structure on the largest scales. We have people in the project who study planets going around nearby stars. I mean, we really span a very, very wide range of backgrounds and interests. OK, so the telescope is in New Mexico. You can see that it's an unusual telescope because it doesn't have a dome. There's actually a shed that rolls off at night that protects it in the rain. The first thing that the survey set out to do was actually to image the sky with a digital camera. So it actually happened to be the largest digital camera in the world at that time. So we basically imaged what ended up being about a third of the sky in five colors. So, ultraviolet through infrared, five different bands. Just to show you some not at all randomly selected pictures from the survey, but really beautiful pictures. This is a very homogeneous and systematic view of the sky. Here's a nearby globular cluster, some interacting galaxies. Here's a small cluster or group of galaxies. So it's been an extremely productive imaging data set. This is a picture of the northern sky. So the galaxy is now kind of, in this projection, it's kind of a polar projection where the galaxy is around the edge. And this is a projection where we've removed all the stars, and all we're showing you is the light from the galaxies. And you can actually, in this picture, start to see some large-scale structure already. But you can also tell that it's really hard to see large-scale structure when you're only looking in two dimensions. We've also done this in the south, southern galactic cap. And all told, this is about one-third of the sky. And this was all released to the public in January 2010. It's actually astonishing to think about how much dynamic range there really is in these pic maps. This slide takes a little chunk of this, not randomly selected, blows it up, blows it up, blows it up. And I don't think from where you're sitting you can see the detail in this final picture. So all told, this is a trillion multicolor pixels. As I say, this is all now available to everybody. In fact, when you look at Google Sky or the World Wide Telescope, a lot of the back, for most parts of the sky, a lot of the backdrop you're actually seeing is from SDSS. All right, but the next job is to turn this into a three-dimensional map. And to do that, we need to measure spectra. Now, the early
projects, the early, you know, from back at the CFA Redshift Survey, for example, people were measuring spectra one at a time. And that, if you want to do millions of objects, would not work because each object takes, you know, either a few minutes or an hour or something. You would need to do something else. And what we do is called fiber spectroscopy. So each one of these optical fibers is going to pluck off the light from a particular chunk of the sky and take it off to our spectrographs. We will measure 1,000 objects at a time, those 1,000 fibers. And the key thing here is this plate at the bottom. And I brought two of them. So we'll pass them around. So this is basically a plate from the survey. So what you should imagine is that this plate sits at the focal plane of the telescope. So if you coated this plate with you know, Polaroid film and exposed it to the sky, you would actually get an image of the sky, which would be about 6 full moons across, which sounds kind of big, but actually takes thousands of plates to cover the sky. The sky is actually really bigger than you think. But so basically, you know, you'd have a picture of the sky. Well, we don't have resource to actually take spectra of all parts, all objects we would see on a plate this big. We might actually see 100,000 objects on a plate this large. We only have resource to do 1,000. So the holes are then drilled at the location of the interesting objects. Maybe they're interesting because they're bright, maybe because they're interesting because they have particular colors, whatever the case may be. So I'll pass these around. They are really big and heavy. You will not hurt, you cannot hurt it. You can hurt the head of the person in front of you. They weigh about 10 pounds, they have sharp edges, so do really be careful passing them around. And I'll get one going on the other side. You may have to get up to move them around, unfortunately. Okay, so the holes that you see in these plates are actually much bigger than the optical part of the fiber. The optical fiber that's plugged into this hole is only the width of a human hair. It's about 120 microns. The holes are actually centered to 10 micron precision. So these actually are each individually drilled for a particular chunk of the sky. And you should think that when we're observing a plate like this, every fiber that's being plucked off here is selecting about one part in 100 billion of the sky that's above you. So if you think about the sky that's above you and you sort of break it up into 100 billion pixels, the telescope is selecting out the light from a single one of those pixels. In that region, there's an object. That object is about a million times fainter than what you can see in a dark sky, probably 10 million times fainter than what you can see in Boston. And we're then taking the light from that and splitting it up into about 2,000 separate wavelength channels. So it's like we're splitting it up into a rainbow, but instead of just 6 rainbow colors, we're splitting it up into 2,000 rainbow colors. And over the course of an hour, we'll record about 100 quanta of light from that object in every one of those frequency channels. And from that measurement, we then figure out where the characteristic quantum transitions are and what the redshift of the object is. Now, you might wonder how we actually get the fibers into the holes. And that's all done by hand. So this is obviously sped up. It takes about an hour for the technicians at the mountain to plug in the fibers. Hurry up, folks. OK, so we have a great team of people doing this at the mountain. In 1 month, they did slightly over 100. The best month we've had a little over 100 plates, so that means there's 100,000 fibers plugged that month. And once the plate is drilled, then it will be brought out to the telescope. I'll show you a movie of that in a minute. But it goes to the back of the telescope and it plugs in here. And the two spectrographs that's actually going to measure the light are right next to it. And they basically will take the ends of the fibers and use the light to disperse them out and make the rainbow. So this just gives you a sense, this movie gives you a sense of the operations on a given night. I'm going to have to speed this up a little bit, but basically, you know, the plates are all housed in these cartridges. Here's one of the observers taking the cartridge out to the telescope. The shed's still on because it's the middle of the day. So they'll bring the telescope up to vertical, and one of the cartridges is already here, so he will wheel the cart up. A little press comes down to take the cartridge off. The next one goes on. These cartridges weigh about 300 pounds, so we need specialty equipment to actually move them around. And he's going to be putting that one away. Now it's nighttime. The shed comes off. The telescope's ready for action. And waiting for it to get dark. We spend a lot of time waiting for it to get dark. So then we have to point that at a single spot on the sky. Of course, the sky moves, so the telescope has to move. And if you look carefully, you'll actually see the stars moving in this time lapse. And if you look really carefully, you'll see the telescope moving to track them. And so we'll observe a plate for about an hour until we get to some suitable signal to noise. And at that point, the next cartridge comes out. We can observe 9 of them in a night. And the plate itself is not used again because it was keyed to that specific spot on the sky. And you know, even though we observed for years and years and years, that is not enough time to actually cover the whole sky. So we you know, we will use that plate for an hour, and then it goes off to public outreach events like this or other stuff. But we can't reuse them. OK. Let's see if I can get here. So the STSS data set at this point is just a gigantic data set. The last data release we had was last month. This released 5 million spectra on 4 million different objects. That means we've actually plugged 5 million fibers into a hole in a metal plate sometime in the last 15 years. We have detected on our imaging over a billion objects, which actually are about half a billion unique objects. We cover the sky more than once. And this is all available. There's really extensive data access tools. So if you're interested in learning about astronomy, it's actually a very good way to learn about astronomy. As Melissa said, I was actually trained in theory. I actually learned most of my observational astronomy by looking at data from the Sloan Survey, early data from the Sloan Survey. So it's really great for astronomers, but also for students and the public. And there's our website. All right, so now let's turn back to the acoustic oscillations. So I just want to give you a bit of a fly-through the data set, give you a feel for what it looks like. So this is now going to take some chunk of the sky, about 20% of the area of the survey. And we're going to be sort of panning out. We're going to be looking at a thin shell of galaxies and then looking at it moving away from us. We're going to start at redshift of 0.15, this little sliver in here, and then this will move out. This circle is this radius of 500 million light years. So as time goes on, you'll see that gets smaller because that is getting further away from us. And all the dots here are just pulled from this little black region. I color-coded the dots so that they start red and then turn to black and then turn to blue, just so you get some feeling of motion, but don't get thrown off by that too much. Do I have a little cursor here? OK, so we're starting off. You can actually see the large-scale structure. Basically, you're sort of taking a slice through the large-scale structure of the universe. So you'll see the various walls and filaments and clusters coming and going as we move along through the survey. Again, this is about 20% of the survey data. So we're now at about 40% of the speed of light. And continuing on, now we're getting to the part where the survey is actually kind of dense. You can actually see the large-scale structure is actually appearing to get smaller and smaller as we go out. That is real. That's the sort of characteristic size of the voids. They are further away, so they appear smaller. We're now in the thick part of the survey. And now we'll get to the point where the objects are too faint for us to observe, and so we'll start to get very sparse. OK, so that's a sense of the large-scale structure of the universe. But that doesn't tell you how to quantify it. You know, you see a random noise pattern, you want to have some method for quantifying it. And the method that I'll use here is called the galaxy correlation function. So the idea is that you sit on a single object on the survey, and you count the number of other objects in some annulus around you. And then you change the radius of that annulus, counting, counting, counting. And now you repeat that count for all possible points in the survey. And you add it up. And that's the correlation function. And when we did this in 2005, we found this bump, which is the characteristic scale of the acoustic oscillations. And this gave us, so this is at 100 H inverse megaparsec, but little H inverse is about 1.5. So this was a measurement of 4% accuracy to the sample. And it's also a really exciting connection because, you know, of the physics that we see in the CMB only 400,000 years after the Big Bang, and now seeing the imprint of it 10 billion years later is really one of the very important aspects of this. So with this detection, we were very emboldened, and we wanted to go out and study it more. And that led to the development of SDSS-3, which used the telescope from mid-2008 to mid-2014. And the key survey in this was the Baran Oscillation Spectroscopic Survey, a part of SDSS-3. So you'll see the word BOSS running around on some of the slides. And the goal of this was to map a big chunk of sky, the largest volume we've yet mapped, and to do so with the intention of measuring these acoustic oscillations in unprecedented detail. And so now, when we think about the acoustic peak in the latest data from BOSS, here's the shape of the peak, and the blue curve is the theory curve that goes underneath it. And this has now allowed us to measure the distance to these galaxies to 1% accuracy. So we've now made a very accurate cosmological distance measurement. In fact, we've made several. We have 1% measurement at redshift 0.57. We also have a 2% measurement at redshift 0.3, a closer set. And of course, we have a very accurate measurement below 0.1%, honestly, in the microwave background. So we have several different redshifts. And that means we can put them on a plot of distance versus redshift. So here are the two BOSS points. There's some points from other surveys. And so we're starting to map out this distance versus redshift relation that I told you about at the beginning. And so now I'll overlay the prediction from the CMB data, assuming a universe that has a cosmological constant and is spatially flat. If you don't know what that means, I'll tell you about it in a minute. But basically making a particular assumption about what the universe is doing. And there it is. So we have a beautiful map of the distance scale that we measure to the distance scale that is predicted in this one cosmological model, which is usually called lambda cold dark matter. So if I now take the prediction and divide through by it, I can look now at residuals, and you can see that there really is percent level agreement between the acoustic oscillation measurements and the values predicted. In detail, our point's about one sigma low, but nobody cares. So it's a very good measurement. Now, already this made us very happy, but there's another aspect of BOSS, which is trying to extend to even higher redshift, and that includes a concept called the Lyman alpha forest. So most of what I've tried to describe to you so far is about measuring correlations of galaxies. But the idea of acoustic oscillation is really that it's a correlation of all the matter in the universe. So anything in the universe that traces matter should cluster with these acoustic oscillations. And one of the things that we can measure very nicely at higher redshift is the presence of neutral hydrogen. We can do this because as light from very distant quasars comes to us, the light will occasionally come into resonance with the transition in hydrogen from the ground state to the first excited state. This is called the Lyman alpha transition, and it's corresponds to a wavelength of 1216 angstroms. So whenever a photon, remember a photon, as it travels through the universe, is getting stretched. And so when its wavelength finally comes into resonance at 1216 angstroms, if there happens to be a neutral hydrogen atom there, it may encounter that hydrogen atom, excite the hydrogen atom from ground state to the first excited state, and very promptly thereafter, the atom will de-excite, but it will re-emit the photon in some random direction. So we won't see it anymore because it went off somewhere else. So every spectrum of a quasar is actually giving us a map of the neutral hydrogen density along the line of sight, not just at one point, at many points, because different photons will come into resonance at different points along the line of sight as the wavelengths stretch. So the big idea in BOSS is to actually use a grid of these quasars. Don't just settle for looking at one quasar and one little pencil beam map of the universe. We're going to take 160,000 of them and look at all the cross correlations between them to try to measure this effect. The really useful thing about this is that quasars are very bright. They're very luminous. You can see them further away than you can see galaxies. And so our galaxy map, although it's beautiful and higher fidelity, is here. We actually get to now measure, and we're there, we get to now measure a big chunk of the universe further away with these quasars. And it's useful because it's more volume. That's good. We get to measure these acoustic oscillations. But also because it's at an earlier time in the universe. And so we've now found this acoustic oscillation in this data as well. We actually can detect these data. Now, I described to you earlier that each one of those little holes is receiving the light from some object that's a million times fainter than we expect. We receive of order 100 quanta of light. And what I'm now telling you in this is that when we receive 100 quanta of light in a single wavelength bin from that quasar, some other quasar 2 or 3 degrees away on the sky, and at that same or some similar wavelength, actually receives 0.1 extra quanta. So you have 100 quanta coming in one spot, you get 0.1 extra quanta at a spot that's about as far away as the diameter of one of these plates. So it's a very, very precise measurement, but now we've made it, and this allows us to measure the expansion rate of the universe and the distance of the universe now at a redshift of 2.4. And that's really fun, because now we can actually see this transition from deceleration to acceleration. When we talk about the accelerating universe, it's not always stressed that the acceleration is only a recent phenomena. The universe was actually decelerating for most of the time, and dark energy has only taken over recently. So this is a plot of redshift, so earlier here, later here, and this is now the velocity that two objects would be moving apart from each other. And we now, you would expect things to be slowing down, and then, oops, they start to take off with dark energy. Well, we'd measured this part really well, but now this is the first time where we've had a point far enough back that we can clearly see that this time was actually, that things were expanding faster at that early time than they were at this intermediate time. Okay, so quantitatively, what do we learn about it? Well, first thing we can talk about is measuring the curvature of the universe. So when we think in general relativity about a universe that's isotropic and homogeneous, then there are three curvatures that can come out. You, of course, can have a universe that's flat. Okay, it's flat as a piece of paper. That's the two-dimensional version, of course. What we really mean is three-dimensional, which means it's flat like this room. Or it could be curved like a sphere. You know, we could be a little ant living on the surface of the sphere. That would give us a curvature. Or it could be crinkled like a saddle, a kind of hyperbolic shape. That's the typical thing. And basically, the impact of this geometry is that the circumference of a circle of a given radius no longer needs to be 2 pi r. You know this very well. If you sit at the North Pole and you go off to the equator and then do a loop around the equator, the loop around the equator has less distance than the distance from the North Pole to the equator walking along the sphere. So the acoustic oscillations give us a wonderful measurement of this. It's been appreciated for 2 decades in cosmology. This would be a great measurement. So you can, if you think about a spherical universe or this curved saddle universe or the flat universe, the size, characteristic size of these spots is changing. You can see they're bigger here, smaller here, and in between here. And you can basically look at the data from one of these pioneering CMB experiments and pick out what the curvature of the universe is. And it comes out to be very close to flat. But now with the acoustic oscillations at low redshift, we can put this on very firm footing. So just taking the fact that we see this fingerprint in the CMB, and we see the same fingerprint in the galaxies at redshifts of 0.3 or 0.5, and the Lyman alpha fours at redshift 2, we can actually now make constraints on the density of matter in units of the critical density, so this is the famous omega matter thing, about 30% here, and the density of dark energy. And you can see that just using the acoustic oscillation as a standard ruler, we now make this very precise measurement of how much dark energy there is. And this dashed line is the flat cosmology. So this is actually giving us a very precise measurement of flatness. But that's assuming that the dark energy is a cosmological constant. We, of course, want to ask more. And one of the basic questions we want to ask is the cosmological constant actually constant? So in particular, is its energy density changing in time? The whole idea of the cosmological constant is that a given cubic centimeter of space weighs some amount. And it will weigh the same amount today as it did 10 billion years ago, as it did, you know, slightly after the Big Bang. That's the idea of the cosmological constant. But maybe it's some other thing. Maybe there's some other energy density which is diluting at some rate and might be changing. And we tend to parameterize this with this parameter W, where W of minus 1 is the cosmological constant. W of 0 is like us. Namely, if you double the size of the universe, you know, increase the volume by a factor of 8, the density decreases by a factor of 8 because the total amount of mass in that volume is conserved. And we can look for this evolution. Now, the plot that I showed you before with this gray swath and showing this beautiful agreement was assuming a flat universe and a cosmological constant. This version shows you how the predictions from the CMB would change if you change these assumptions. So if you say that the universe instead has a curvature of only 1%, so a tiny deviation, then it would actually move the predictions down here. You can see it's immediately not as good a match to the data. If instead you said, oh, well, the dark energy is not the cosmological constant. It's in fact changing, and the amount of the density is getting lower in time, not as quickly as matter, but it is changing, then you would get this curve. So you can see that measuring these things as a function of redshift can start to figure out which of these cases we're in. And with the recent data, if we make a plot of curvature, where here is flat, 0, and W, where here is minus 1, the cosmological constant, our data now pushes us back to this little region, very nicely matching up to what you might think of as the simplest or the null hypothesis model. In detail, the curvature constraints are below a percent. We're about 10% on W. We measure the matter density of the universe to be 31% of critical. And the Hubble constant, which of course people had argued about at the factor of 2 level, is now 67 plus or minus 2. So it's a very, very beautiful confirmation of this simplest model of a flat universe and a cosmological constant. We opened up 2 new degrees of freedom in the model, and the data drives us back to the simplest form. Okay, so to start to move towards the end, I think cosmology is now at the end of the beginning, to quote, I think it was Churchill. We have a very concrete, predictive, simple, elegant theory for how the universe works, clearly since an age of 1 second, and if you believe inflation, then going back much further than that. So it's really an amazing thing. We can specify the universe 1 second after the Big Bang, and we have a very predictive theory for how all of cosmology and large-scale structure evolves, and it's been tested in many different ways. It's a beautiful experimental situation. And the theory of how to evolve this, if you just say it's cold dark matter and a cosmological constant, we can run simulations all day to explore how that's going to behave. But we don't know what the cold dark matter is, and we don't know what the dark energy is. So, that's the fly in the ointment. But it's also a great opportunity. This is where the field is trying to explore in the coming decade. And there are many data sets coming online that are going to allow us to measure this. We really expect to see factors of 100 increase in the major data sets over the coming year, coming decade. So there's just enormous reach from this data on lots of questions in cosmology, not just dark energy, but many, many subtle issues and lots of galaxy formation items. Okay, so to conclude, acoustic oscillations provide a robust way to measure the distance scale. We can see we have simple physics from the early universe that predicts these things. It leaves a very clean signature in galaxy clustering. And it's now established itself over the past 10 years as a very important tool in the study of our cosmic expansion history and dark energy and dark matter. So in the context of STSS, we've been using it to measure the distance to percent level accuracy. We find excellent consistency with the flat cosmology with the cosmological constant. And there's just lots of cosmological opportunities for the next generation. We're looking for dark matter and dark energy anywhere we can. So this is my kid. And so with that, I will thank you for your time. And I'll encourage you to learn more about the survey at our website or come talk to me afterwards. Thanks.
So I finally understand it. Thank you. That was really that was the best talk just my level. I'm sure there are questions, and I have a microphone. So if anybody wants to ask a question, they can just raise their hand, and I'll bring them the microphone. Oh, you have to be so far away.
I can take it back down.
I'm sorry. I sort of didn't understand the key point, which was where this 150 megaparsecs comes from. I thought you were saying that you're having sound waves that start at a point and they expand
right.
for 400,000 years,
right.
and then they're decoupled. But if they expand for 400,000 years, how can you get a length scale?
Yeah, that's a good question. I didn't go into that. But so what you've said is exactly right. The issue then is that the universe continues to expand. So when I say that it's 150 megaparsecs, I'm measuring in units of today's universe. So if you go for 400,000 years, and you might think that would be 400,000 light years, but actually some of that was done at times when the universe was even smaller, so you get sort of extra credit, bonus credit for the early stuff. And then when you get done, you get another factor of 1,000 expansion, and that's where the 500 million light years comes from.
Yeah. Come on, I know there are questions.
One of your early slides that was motivating that there were acoustical waves, the one that showed the 8 or 9 mm-hmm. overdone, was that a notional slide or is that real?
No, that's real data.
Okay. How do we understand that the first and second harmonics have the same amplitudes?
So that's a good question. The details of the relative heights actually depends upon a fair bit of stuff which I didn't get into. So. A big effect is this thing called silk damping. That if I say, okay, well, look, we talked about sound waves traveling, but in fact, if you set up sound waves on really small scales, the diffusion times are large enough that the sound wave would get washed out. So there's actually an overall damping of all the waves that are small wavelength actually are getting suppressed by this silk damping. So honestly, if that silk damping weren't happening, if the cross-section were enormous, then actually the peaks would increase further and further. They would actually increase by a factor of 25 going to the right of the plot. And that's just all being crushed by this damping. There are other aspects that, much like a drum head, if you hit a drum head and you listen to the overtones, you can infer composition of the drum head or shape of the drum head. It's the same thing here. We can actually, by looking at the relative heights of these peaks, we can infer things about the density of the universe, both in terms of the normal matter, the protons, and also in terms of dark matter. So for example, if you have more normal matter, then all the odd-numbered peaks get higher. So we actually read a lot out of the peak structure, which just wasn't. I couldn't get into all of it.
Any young people have questions?
Not sure what the age limit is, but. Yes. So it's really looking at all possible pairs. I'm just trying to get back to the slide that'll help. So it's really we're looking at all possible pairs. You basically are sitting on any point in the survey, any galaxy in the survey, and counting all the galaxies in a ring. And you're doing this as a function of radius. So basically, you get some number of counts. Boom, more counts, and then fewer counts. So that's the peak you're looking for.
So you're actually looking at all possible.
You look at all possible pairs.
So I have a question. How many Nobel Prizes are going to come out of the baryon acoustic oscillations? I mean, there was the discovery of them, then there's this stuff that's incredibly beautiful.
The CMB overall is just a tremendous success story. In cosmology, and we're all, very, very excited about it. So I think that, the story in the CMB will almost surely win a Nobel Prize at some point. Who they will choose to give it to, because it's an experimental endeavor, there's lots of people involved, I don't know. But it is so much the fundamental measurement in cosmology. And really, these acoustic peaks are all of what you're seeing. Like almost everything in the CMB is these sound waves. So it's just a gigantic part of the story.
So in your talk, you discussed the universe as one thing, and I heard that there are discussions on possible broader concepts like multiverses and so on. Is it possible to learn about them by some indirect way using these harmonics and different kind of higher oscillations?
So yes, I mean people talk a lot about where does the universe come from, and we really think about particularly concepts of inflation. We are led to these ideas that maybe we're only living in a very small part of an inflating universe, and maybe other parts are doing something else. And absolutely, data in the CMB is a big part of that story. So we are able in the CMB to measure perturbations which are large, very, very large perturbations, the size of the current observable universe, and that is very indicative of things that happen in inflation. Of course, there's the whole story of gravitational waves, which we all now are much more familiar with. So we try to tease out properties of this inflation from these kinds of data. Now, of course, we will never be able to directly observe things in these other multiverses. The structure of the space-time decouples them from us. We're not going to be that lucky to see them. Unfortunately, my suspicion is that no matter how much we can learn about inflation from our little chunk of the universe, it'll be hard to definitively prove or disprove these multiverse ideas. But it's possible that I'm on the conservative side of that. I don't know. The acoustic oscillations themselves are probably not the most important part of the inflation story in the context of the microwave background. The microwave background has many important interpretations, and inflation is definitely one of them, but it's a little bit less through those acoustic oscillations.
Okay, oh, Jack.
I should say that I, not to put off the question, but I did, for those who want to learn more about how the plates are actually drilled, I did bring a movie of that. So I'll answer the question now. We can.
So I was just wondering if in the galaxy correlation functions, do you expect to see these higher harmonics?
The answer is no, but let me explain why. I explained this in the context of a correlation function, which isolates this specific length scale. The work that we showed in the microwave background was doing everything in terms of wavelengths. It's a Fourier space representation. And just like an organ pipe or a violin string, there's a single physical scale, the length of the string or the length of the pipe, and it gives rise to all these overtones. You can have many frequencies which satisfy the boundary conditions. In the correlation function, we're really kind of directly measuring the boundary conditions. In the microwave background, we're measuring the frequency structure. So you see a single peak in the acoustic oscillations. You see many peaks in the power spectrum. When we make a power spectrum plots, I didn't bring one because they're harder to explain, but when we make power spectrum plots, we do see multiple wavelengths. About four. We don't get to see nine yet, but we see a bunch.
OK, you know what I think we should do? We should thank the speaker again.
Well, thank you.
Daniel again. And then you can ask some questions, come up if you have.
Please.